So we're continuing to look at the problem. Suppose we have a series, an infinite sum, and we want to make a decision. Do we converge or do we not converge? In other words, do we diverge? And how do we do it? Now, we have some tests so far, but of course, more tests can be helpful. And in particular, we'd like to develop some tests which are very easy to apply. So our goal for today is to look at two more tests, the root test and the ratio test. Now, what makes these tests so wonderful is it says by looking at just the series, the individual terms by themselves, we can sometimes come to a decision. In other words, we don't have to make comparisons with some other series, because comparisons can be hard because you have to come up with comparisons. And here we're like, no, you don't have to come up with comparisons. In essence, we're comparing the sequence of things that we're adding to itself to try to get an understanding of what's going on. Well, let's begin. So we're going to start by looking at the ratio test. And as we say here, look, our goal is let's understand the growth. How are things growing? So how does the ratio test work? Well, it says suppose you have some sequence of numbers a sub n, and we're going to assume that they're positive. Don't worry, in the near future, we're going to be able to handle some negative things as well. And then what we're going to say is, let's look at two consecutive terms. In other words, a sub n plus 1 divide by a sub n. And take the limit as n goes to infinity. And let's suppose that there is a limit. All right. Well, what do we have? There's a couple possibilities. Maybe the limit is below 1. And in that case, our conclusion will be, great, the sum converges. Maybe the limit is above 1. And then we'll say, ah, great, the sum diverges. Or maybe the limit is 1. And we say, I don't know, try something else. And so that's the conclusion. So in other words, by understanding what's happening to this limit, we can make a decision, converge, diverge, or try something else. Now, it is the case that almost always there has to be an inconclusive part. So the inconclusive part is 1. There's a couple of things to note here. We have seen limits before. When we talked about limit comparison tests, remember that one? They said, look at a sub n over b sub n and see what it goes to. And in a limit comparison test, we only care that it went to a number. We didn't care what the number was. We just needed to be a number. Here, it's pay attention to the number. So it is different. And in particular, we want to say, well, how does it behave? Is it less than 1 or is it bigger than 1? Now, why do we care about this threshold of 1? Well, what we should be thinking of is to say that an plus 1 over an, the limit is rho. Intuitively, that says, an plus 1 over an is approximately like rho. Or, put another way, an plus 1 looks like rho times a sub n. And what's our intuition? Well, if rho is large, bigger than 1, it says, your next term is going to be bigger than the current term. In other words, the term should get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. If your terms get big, the series has to diverge. If rho is below 1, what does that say? The terms are getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. But, of course, it's not enough to be small. Not only are they getting small, in some sense, they're getting small in some sort of geometric or, if you like, exponential way. And so it's like, so that should converge. Now, what about rho equals 1? It says something like an plus 1 is kind of close to an. And unfortunately, we just don't have enough information to say, but look, how quickly are you going to 0? Questions about converge or diverge almost always boil down to the question, how quickly do we approach 0? If our terms that we're adding up go to 0 very quickly, converge. If they go very slowly, diverge. they don't go to zero at all, really diverge. Extra diverge. Now diverge plus plus. And so that's what we're after. So we're going to take a look, just make it a little bit cleaner. You know, this is our sort of intuitive understanding. Before we do, I want to point something out. So ratio test is great for anything which involves factorials. So if you see a factorial, in the back of your mind, you should say ratio test. Now, why? Well, factorials are kind of hard to work with because they're not really a nice continuous function in some sense. And so a lot of the things that we have don't mesh well with factorials. But they do work really well when you look at ratios of factorials. So in particular, what can you do? Well, let's look at something like, say, n plus 2 factorial. Now, as a reminder, what does factorial mean? Factorial means you start the current number, and you start there, and you keep multiplying, dot, 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 down till you get to 1. So, for instance, here, you say, all right, the first term would be n plus 2. Next term would be n plus 1. Next term would be n. Then the term after that, n minus 1. And keep going all the way down to 1. That's what that means. But here's the key. Look at this last part. What does it look like? It looks like a factorial because it's a factorial. See, good reason why it looks like that. So what you have is it's n plus 2 times n plus 1 times n factorial. Or put another way, hey, n plus 2 factorial over n factorial is very simple. It cleans up. N plus 2 times n plus 1. Another way to think about what's going on, and if you can get this, it really helps whenever you have factorials, is that when you have factorials, it's like you pull off the first term. So, for instance, you could have said, look, n plus 2 factorial, pull off the first term, n plus 2, and then there's n plus 1 factorial. Or you could have said, look, pull off the first term, n plus 2, then pull off another term, n plus 1, and now you're like, great, I'm happy with that, and the rest will go into the factorial of what remains. So this is how we work with factorials. Pull off the first however many terms we need, usually to drive that, you know, plus whatever down till it's plus 0. All right, so how does the ratio test work? Well, here's the idea. It's actually pretty simple. And what we're going to do is going to say, look, things should be behaving like a geometric sequence. So, what's true? Well, if rho is less than 1, so what do you have? You have, here's the numbers, here's 1, and here's rho. And here's an important thing. If rho is below 1, there's a gap. You know, mind the gap. So here's your value for rho, here's your value for 1. There's space. And that's why there's hope. Because there's space, we could say, all right, there's a little bit further, you know, somewhere in between our value rho and 1, there's this rho plus epsilon. And what we can say now is not just sort of like vaguely for large and it's true, but we can say, no, for n sufficiently large. And we can say, you know, because the definition of limit says that, you know, far enough out, you have to be close to your limit. So for sufficiently large n, it has to be the case that this ratio, a n plus 1 over a n, is strictly less than rho plus epsilon. So now, we definitely know we're definitively below 1 from that point on. So a n plus 1 is less than a n times rho plus epsilon. But now, here's the thing. What can you do? Well, let's suppose I look at not an plus 1, but an plus 2. Okay, well, what could happen there? So an plus 2, well, according to the rule, that's less than an plus 1 times rho plus epsilon. But now, I say, wait, that's less than an times rho plus epsilon times rho plus epsilon, right? Because I can apply the same idea to the an plus 1. Or I could say, look, that's an rho plus epsilon squared. So because there's that plus 2, that translates into a 2 there. And in general, I can say, look, this an plus k is less than an times rho plus epsilon to the k. That plus k matches that k. So what it tells us is that, look, the first couple terms, whatever, we don't care. But in the tail, and remember, everything happens in the tail when it comes to converging, diverging, it's decreasing, bounded above by an exponential function, and bounded above by an exponential function which converges. So we can say, all right, we can do a comparison test between just our normal sequence and then this a sub n times rho plus epsilon to the k. Again, in the tail, we don't care what happens at the start, the tail. And so we have to converge. All right, and that's the idea. Now, what happens if rho is bigger than 1? Okay, if rho is bigger than 1, here's 1, and here's rho. All right, so great. So here's 1, here's rho. We can find something in the middle. So now it's a rho minus a little bit, but now the exact same thing. And so what happens? Well, a sub n times rho minus epsilon to the k. And it's just, wow, bigger, 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 bigger. And we could say, oh, well, now that's bounded by some divergent series. It's actually even simpler than that, right? Because what can you say? If the terms keep getting bigger, 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 what can't they do? They can't go to zero. And if the terms don't go to zero, it has to be a diverging series. And that's our conclusion. All right, so there we go. The ratio test. Look at next term over current term, take a limit, see what happens. Now there's another test. And this one is called the root test. Now, what does the root test do? It says, look, suppose, again, we have positive terms, and now, instead of taking a look at a ratio, take a look at a root. All right, in particular, the limit as n goes to infinity of a sub n to the 1 over n power. Okay, great. Well, what's our conclusion? Well, our conclusion, look, if we're below 1, some converges. If we're above 1, some diverges. And if we're equal to 1, I don't know, try something else, right? And that's going to be consistent. If we ever have 1, like, try a different thing. And again, our intuition says, why? Well, it's telling us that, look, this says for large enough an, a sub n to the 1 over n, it's approximately rho, or a sub n is approximately rho to the n power. So in other words, it's behaving like a geometric series. And we know, hey, if our term in our geometric series is small, it converges. If it's large, it diverges. Now the 1 is because, well, it's behaving like it, but maybe it's still going down to 0 just fast enough so that it can work. Now, between root and ratio, a general rule of thumb is if you see factorial, you're going to think ratio. Otherwise, both tend to work. Root tends to be a little bit easier. If you see n up in the exponent, definitely, if you can, again, if there's factorials, forget it. You have to do ratio. But if you see n up in the exponent, root makes a wonderful way to approach the problem. And so look for that. There are certain things to look for. One helpful thing to remember when you're doing the root test, we've talked about this limit before, limit as n goes to infinity of n to the 1 over n power is equal to 1. So that's a good thing to keep in mind. Another thing to keep in mind, we'll write it down here, limit as n goes to infinity of 1 plus x over n to the power n is e to the x. And so that's another thing that you might see. All right, great, wonderful, good stuff, wonderful, good stuff. Now, what do we do? Well, the last thing for us to do is to say, well, why does the root test work? And really, it's like we said, our intuition, a sub n, is behaving like an exponential function. So it's the same sort of process, right? So we say, okay, if rho is less than 1, there's 1, there's rho. All right, so you have 1 and rho, there's something in the middle. And we say, all right, there's this rho plus epsilon, somewhere in between. And now for large enough n, right, because that's what I'm going to say, for n large enough, you have to be close, we can see it right here. A sub n to the 1 over n is below rho plus epsilon. Well, a sub n is below rho plus epsilon to the n, which means, because rho plus epsilon is small, that our terms are going to 0 very fast, at least exponential. And if you're decaying at least exponentially fast, you have to converge. Same process, if rho is bigger than 1, okay, in that case, what do we see? Well, say, look, then there's some space, there's a gap. As they would say, mind the gap. So we can squeeze in right there. And now we say, wow, a sub n to the 1 over n, it's bigger than rho minus epsilon, but that's above 1. So now a sub n is large. And so what does that mean? It means the terms are getting big. Boop, 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 boop. They're blowing up as we head off to infinity. Forget it. Hopeless. No chance to converge. Can't be done. Can't be done. All right. Well, good. So there you go. Root and ratio test. Wonderful test, by the way. Really great, wonderful test. And of course, the way you get a handle of what to do is practice. The more practice you do, the better you become, the more amazing you're going to become. So make sure you go do that practice, and I hope to see you soon. Bye.